Good morning, everyone. On behalf of Sankhya, the Mathematical Society of Miranda House, I welcome you all to this workshop on group theory. To mark its beginning, let us seek the divine blessings of Goddess Saraswati. I'll now invite Tejasvi Mishra of BSc Mathematics second year for recitation of Saraswati Vandana.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Hello. Okay. तो ओम या देवी सर्वभूतेषु विद्या रूपेण संस्थिता नमस्तस्ये 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 नमो नमः हे शारदे मां हे शारदे मां अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे मां हे शारदे मां हे शारदे मां अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे मां तू स्वर की देवी है संगीत तुझसे हर शब्द तेरा है हर गीत तुझसे तू स्वर की देवी है संगीत तुझसे हर शब्द तेरा है हर गीत तुझसे हम हैं अकेले हम हैं अधूरे तेरी शरण हम हमें प्यार दे माँ ये शार दे माँ ईशार दे मां अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे मां ईशार दे मां ईशार दे मां अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे मां मुनियों ने समझी है गुनियों ने जानी वेदों की भाषा पुराणों की वाणी मुनियों ने समझी है गुनियों ने जानी वेदों की भाषा पुराणों की वाणी हम भी तो समझें हम भी तो जाने विद्या का हमको अधिकार दे माँ हे शार दे माँ हे शार दे माँ अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे माँ तू श्वेत वर्णी कमल पे विराजे हाथों में वीणा मुकुट सर पे साजे तू श्वेत वर्णी कमल पे विराजे हाथों में वीणा मुकुट सर पे साजे मन से हमारे मिटाकर अंधेरे हमको जालों का संसार दे माँ हे शार दे माँ हे शार दे माँ अज्ञानता से हमें तार दे माँ धन्यवाद
थैंक यू तेजस्वी दैट वाज ट्रूली मिस कोऑर्डिनेटर ऑफ द वर्कशॉप द वेलकम एड्रेस
गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन Department of Mathematics, Miranda House, believes that there is much more to be explored beyond the classroom teaching, which enables students to have a better understanding of the subject. The department is always instrumental in providing such platforms through workshops and seminars. We have come up with a 3-day workshop on group theory to make the subject more interesting and enjoyable. Today we have with us Professor Geeta Venkatraman and Dr. Amit Kulshesh as our eminent speakers for this workshop. We would like to thank them for taking out their valuable time from their busy schedule for sharing their knowledge and expertise with us. 70 participants comprising of second year and third years and 15 mentors across various colleges have joined us for the workshop. I welcome you all for your participation, for your continued interest, and also in advance for the lively discussion which we'll certainly have throughout the workshop. Looking forward to your active participation. I also thank our principal ma'am for providing us all the support to conduct this workshop.
Thank you, ma'am. The workshop will be conducted over 3 days, that is 27th, 28th and 29th of January. There will be 6 lectures and 3 tutorials in total. Each day, 2 lectures and 1 tutorial will be conducted. We are honored to have Professor Geeta Venkatraman, who is currently a professor of mathematics at Dr. B.R. Ambedkar University, Delhi, with us. Professor Venkatraman completed her BSc in mathematics at St. Stephen's College, University of Delhi, and stood first in Delhi University for the field. She was offered the In-Lakh Scholarship and the Burton Senior Scholarship from Oriel College, University of Oxford, from where she completed her master's and doctorate respectively. Ma'am is the founding member of Mathematics Teacher Association India. She is also a member of committee for giving suggestions for activities under Bhaskaracharya's second study chair, sanctions to Akamadevi Women's. She is a co-author of a research monograph titled Enumeration of Finite Groups, published in 2007. Moreover, Professor Venkatraman has authored numerous books, articles, research papers, book reviews, and many more. Ma'am is also a named bird watcher, baker, and a photographer. She won the joint second prize for the photograph titled River Fractals at the Asia-Australia Algebra Conference 2019, held at Western Sydney University, Sydney, Australia. We welcome you, ma'am. Another distinguished speaker that we have with us is Dr. Amit Kulshrestha from IIFL Mohali. Dr. Amit Kulshrestha is an associate professor in the Department of Mathematical Sciences at Indian Institute of Science Education and Research, Mohali, since 2008. Prior to that, he was a visiting institute, Bangalore, Delhi, and a postdoctorate researcher at Université Catholique de Louvain, Belgium. He did his PhD from Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Mumbai, in the broad area of algebra. His research interests include central simple algebra, quadratic forms, linear algebraic groups, word map on groups. He is also interested in interacting with school teachers and students and pedagogy of mathematics. Sir is also fond of reading Hindi literature, particularly 20th century Hindi poetry and Indian history. We welcome you, sir. We express our gratitude to the esteemed professors who have allotted their valuable time to enlighten us with their knowledge and experience. We also thank our teachers for organizing this workshop that would be truly instrumental in helping a newer perspective to the conventions of research. I would now invite Professor Venkatraman to start with the first lecture. Thank you.
Good morning. Can you all hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Hi. It's such a pleasure to be part of this workshop, and it brought back memories when you said I studied in Stephen's. So I was an undergraduate a long, long time ago, and I think it was in during our time we did not have abstract algebra in the first year. The syllabus was, first year syllabus was a lot like school syllabus in those days. It's only in the second year that we did abstract algebra and analysis. And I guess that's when I kind of fell in love with mathematics, and that love has continued. And I hope that today, in the next 3 days during this workshop, I'm able to convey to all of you, you're already math students and you're attending the workshop because you like mathematics, but I hope to cement that love for you. And it's something that will stay with you lifelong. What Amit and I had a discussion when this workshop came up on group theory, and we were trying to figure out what would be best to present to all of you in the 3 days that we have. And we've put together something that I hope you will all enjoy. Now, we are in a, you know, during the pandemic, it's, I think all of you have also gotten used to having your classes online in this way. As a person lecturing, I have to tell you that it's very disconcerting not to be able to see and interact with your audience. And I think therefore it's important for all of us, me as well as all of you, to try and make this as interactive as possible. And so what I am going to say, and I hope you will actually do this, is that please interrupt if there is something that you don't understand or something that you want me to explain a lot more than I have done. And we also have mentors here. So even if you put something in the chat box, they will be able to interrupt me and ask me those questions. I thought I thought I would start by telling you all a little bit about the history of group theory, how group theory originated. Now, one of the things that I find, when I studied mathematics, as well as I think for a lot of you, there is a tendency to assume that because the way we study mathematics and particularly group theory, you would probably have your teacher on the very first day give you a kind of intuitive understanding of what a group is, and then maybe immediately almost go into the axioms that are required for a non-empty set to satisfy to become a group. And what you have to realize is that it took hundreds of years before that kind of a definition of what a group is, the way we study it, has come about. So I thought I'd tell you a little bit more about the history of groups. Just a quick introduction, I mean, like a brief history. And then because all of you have done quite a bit of group theory, I thought we would do a very quick review of what I expect you people to know. And so that'll be sort of a revision of the kind of group theory that you've already done. And after that, I will actually start with what I want to do in the workshop in the first two lectures, which is going to be on group actions and related material to that. So I will be sharing my screen soon and presenting. So I have some slides initially, after which I'll start actually using a tab to do my lecture. So just give me a moment while I open my slides. Okay, can you all see the screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, so as I said, the initial part is I'm going to take you through a brief history and also a quick review of group theory. And even here, I would welcome any interruption in case you have any doubts or anything that you want me to clarify. So, of course, when you look at groups, there are different directions from which group theory kind of developed. But the one that I'm going to trace is something that all of you would probably be familiar with, but have not maybe thought that groups could have originated in this manner. I think it's probably in 8th, 9th, maybe 10th standard when you looked at quadratic equations. During my time, it used to be in 10th standard, but I don't know now. But one of the things that you learned when you encountered quadratic equations was, so if you have an equation of the type ax square plus bx plus c equals 0, where a, b, and c are non-zero, are real numbers, and a is non-zero, you learned how to write down the solutions of this equation. Okay. And in fact, one of the things that you ask almost any school student to tell you, you know, what the roots of a quadratic equation are, they'll immediately rattle off the formula. You know, minus b plus minus under root b square minus 4ac divided by 2a. And I have to, however, share a little anecdote here. When I was a school student, I had a cousin who was older. And during the summer break, we had all gotten together. And she had already encountered quadratic equations. And she told me, she showed me this method of completing the squares. And I thought it was, you know, what a magical proof that was. You know, suddenly you had this, equation, and somehow you did this trick, which was completing the squares. And then you could use it to actually get the roots of the quadratic equation. But I mean, so I'm sure all of you would have encountered these little pieces which you carry with you for the rest of your life, where you saw some new bit of mathematics and it really excited you. But coming back to quadratic equations, what we saw there was that you have this equation and you're able to write the roots using the coefficients. And what did you do on the roots? It was basically arithmetic. You had addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division, and along with it, extraction of roots. So the question was, and this is something that in the 1700s and 1600s bothered mathematicians, particularly in Europe. The question was that if you have a cubic equation, so if you're looking at ax cube plus bx square plus cx plus d, where a is non-zero and the coefficients are, say, real numbers, can you again write down a formula for the three roots of the cubic equation using just arithmetic on the coefficients and extraction of roots? And pretty soon, I wouldn't say pretty soon, it took probably a good part of half a decade, but they had discovered that you could actually have a formula for writing down the roots of cubic equations and of quartic equations, so degree four equations. And so obviously then the question was, what about degree five and higher? And for a long time, people were not able to figure out whether you could actually write down the roots, or, you know, I mean, writing down the roots would mean finding formulae in general. But to be able to show that you can't write down the roots of a fifth degree equation, you can obviously see there's a difference in the type of problem that you're looking at. You would have to actually somehow prove theoretically that you are not able to do it. And you'll see you've already encountered Abel because you've looked at abelian groups, but he was the first one to show that a fifth degree equation, you cannot write down, if you have a general fifth degree equation, you cannot write down the roots of that equation by in a formula involving the coefficients. When you can write the roots in using a formula involving the coefficients, then we say that the equation is solvable by radicals. That extraction of root is what is called the radical part is coming from there. Okay, so you have this situation now where you managed to show that up to four things work, you can solve by radicals. And if you have a degree five equation in general, of course, particular equations, you can write down the roots. But if you have a fifth degree equation in general, then you're not able to solve it by radicals. And then the question was, what about fifth degree and higher? And so that's around the space where I want to start showing you my slides. And what you'll see is, mathematicians whose names you're probably familiar with, and the kind of contributions they did, which led us to where we are able to study groups in the manner that we are going to do so. Okay, so let me see, how do I get my I think I have to use this probably. Yeah, okay. So Lagrange, I mean, so this is again a name which is very familiar to you. In fact, this is one of the big results in group theory that you do when you're studying group theory, Lagrange's theorem for finite groups. But Lagrange in 1770 investigated equations of degree four, and he was trying to figure out why they could be solved by radicals. And he, in fact, at that point, looked at permutations, but the composition of permutations is not something that he actually did. So you have Lagrange in 1770 doing a little bit related to equations again. And then Ruffini, in fact, Ruffini is the one, he had a failed attempt in the sense that he felt that he had proved that a degree five equation could not be solved by radicals in 1799, but there was a error in his proof, and his work was also largely ignored by by the mathematicians at that point. And if you look at the kind of work he did in the way we understand groups, his work was related to permutation groups. But you must remember that along with the maths that we study now, the terminology we use, the symbols we use have also developed. Okay, so when you look at a piece of writing which is from 1799, you also have to learn to translate it in a way, not just in terms of the language. Maybe it was written in Italian and then you need to translate it into English, but also the terminology that was used, you have to try and figure out what it means in terms of how we understand, say, permutations or permutation groups or groups. Okay, so Cauchy was, however, somebody who did pay some attention to what Ruffini did. And Cauchy is, again, a mathematician you should be familiar with, because you would have done Cauchy's theorem as part of your group theory course. And then we come to Cauchy himself. So he, as I've written in the slide, he was one of the people who did recognize Ruffini's work. And in 1821, he writes this to Ruffini saying that your memoir on the general resolution of equations is a work which has always seemed to me worthy of the attention of mathematicians, and which in my judgment proves completely the impossibility of solving algebraically equations of higher than the fourth degree. Of course, it's not, if you look back on the work that Ruffini did, what Cauchy is saying here is not really true, but Cauchy believed that there was something to what Ruffini had done. And then Abel. So Abel was aware of both Ruffini's and Cauchy's work. Remember, Ruffini is working in 1799, and in 1824, Abel proves the impossibility of solving the general equation of the fifth degree by radicals. And he published this along with six other papers in the very first volume of Crell's journal. Crell's journal is, I think it's the oldest journal in mathematics that we have. And it obviously began in 1824. I would urge, if you people have a chance, to look at some of the older papers that mathematicians wrote at that time, at least the translations, and you will find it's actually readable. They're trying to explain to you how they've been thinking about the problem, which you don't find in any of the modern papers. I mean, you're not expected to elaborate your thinking process, but just to present the evidence of your thinking. So, but if you go back and look at those papers, they're actually sort of trying to communicate to you as to why they thought about this problem, and it's like a little, it's like a story which unfolds. So it's worth going back and looking at some of these original papers in, of course, in translation, because you would not be able to, unless you know the language. And from Abel, we go to Galois. I mean, so Galois is somebody who's such a romantic figure. It's 1830, he's just 19 years old. He essentially, you know, invented groups to solve the problem that he was looking at. And he had a, in a sense, a difficult, career path, I would say, because he was someone who did not manage to make it to the best institutions for doing mathematics in France. He was doing mathematics, which was far beyond his time, and people didn't really understand what he was doing. And but what he has done is such that it stood the test of time. It has, in fact, he was one of the people who linked groups and field extensions. And now you have an area of mathematics, which is called Galois theory, where you study these connections. And what did he actually do? He actually solved this problem of, you know, whether you can solve an equation by radicals by translating that problem from questions about equations to questions related to the permutations on the roots of these equations. And the moment you are looking at permutations, they are objects which are parts of, you know, you have a group of permutations, and you can use your group theoretic knowledge and structure to study them. And what he managed to show basically was that an equation could be solved by radicals if and only if a particular group that you could associate with, which was essentially a permutation group on the roots of the equations, satisfied some group theoretic condition. And it was an if and only if situation. That is, you could go both ways. And that helped him to show that if you take a degree 5 polynomial or higher, that it's now called the Galois group. The Galois group associated with those equations do not satisfy that group theoretic property. It's called solvability. I might tell you something about it or not, but right now, let's just assume that this is a property. And what he showed was that these Galois groups do not have that property, and therefore the equations could not be solved by radicals. And see, he's just 21 years old and he dies. And you should read an account of Galois' life, and he got involved in the politics around that time. And it's quite an interesting thing. In fact, his mathematical work also keeps getting lost, and it's essentially after his death that things come to light in a big way. So the knight, and he dies because he fights a duel. Now there are stories about why he fought the duel. I'll leave you to discover it. But the night before he fought the duel, which led to his death, Galois made notes on his papers. One of these notes, made on 29th May 1832, was the following: if in such a group one has substitutions S and T, then one has the substitution ST. So substitution was the word which was used for permutations. So he's talking about the fact that if you have that, the kind of groups that he was looking at, if you had two permutations S and T belonging to that group, then there's closure there. Of course, he was dealing with finite groups, and I mean, this is the one of the earliest places where you're looking at concepts like, you know, closure, operation. He's someone who discusses normal subgroups actually, and so on in his work. And what you see after that is Poisson, Liouville, Jordan, all of them tried to understand and explain Galois' work with varying degrees of success. And eventually it was published after Galois died, his work, and led to the development of Galois theory. So now we are in 1832, and even now we do not really have the concept of an abstract group. So people are doing work which has led them to look at groups in terms of, you know, maybe the properties they have, in terms of, you know, how you can use them to solve other problems, but the notion of an abstract group has still not made its way. And Cayley, again, Cayley is somebody you'd encounter. There's a Cayley's theorem that maybe we'll go into. So Cayley is somebody who's in 1854, and then again in 1878, he tried to define a group in terms of symbols. So he was trying to get to this notion of an abstract group. But even though he had some correct ideas, he was not able to give the definition that we do use now. And in 1882, Walther von Dick, who was Felix Klein's PhD student. So Klein is a mathematician who, you may have heard of something called the Klein's bottle, which is like a three, if you know about the Mobius strip, then the Klein's bottle will be something you should be interested in. And otherwise, go look up Mobius strip as well as the Klein's bottle. Klein was also someone who was very interested in how mathematics should be taught. So he's one of the earliest mathematicians who's writing about how math should be taught, math's education, and so on. So again, Klein is a very interesting figure. And von Dyck is his PhD student. And he is one of the people who actually did manage to define an abstract group. And in 1897, you have Burnside. So this is Cayley, Dyck, and Burnside. He published his famous book, Theory of Groups of Finite Order. But he also tended to look at group elements as operators. I mean, they basically act on something. And today, in fact, we are going to go back to that. It's a full circle in a sense. So we start out with thinking of groups as permutations which are acting on something. Maybe it's roots of an equation, or it might be vertices of an equilateral triangle, and so on. And then we've, you know, there's a period when we move from there into abstract groups. A huge amount of group theory develops. It's still developing. And today we are going to go back in a way and realize that all groups in a sense are groups of operators. So in a way, we're going to come to a full circle this time. And Cayley's theorem is what tells you that you can always look at a abstract group and see it as a group of permutations. Okay, so there are others also who do give definitions of an abstract group. And here is a little picture which sort of gives you, so one direction which we have traced is Galois, Cayley, Dyck, Burnside, 20th century definition. But there are other roots. There are roots which are coming from a number theoretic point of view. There are roots which are coming from a geometric and topological point of view to come to a group. So what is an abstract group? And that's something I think you'll all be far more familiar with. And because these are things that you are familiar with, I'm just going to go over it fairly quickly. So a non-empty set G with a binary operation star is called a group. So the moment you have binary operation, it's already closed. You'll find a lot of the time that closure is emphasized once again, but frankly, the moment you have a binary operation, closure is taken as part of that definition. So if you have a binary operation on a non-empty set, all you require it to be is associative. Then you need to have an identity element and you need to have inverses. And if you have these three things satisfied with respect to that binary operation, then we call such a set a non-empty set, a group. And usually when you're studying a group, the operation is automatically assumed to be there. You assume that there is a fixed operation on that particular group. Sometimes it's explicitly written using the star and other times it's invisible. But you have to constantly remember that when you are trying to combine two elements in a group, what you're using is the operation that exists there. Okay. And if the direction in which you combine these elements do not matter, that is, if A star B is B star A, then we say that the group is abelian. And the term abelian is coming from Abel, whom we saw earlier. And then you can show quite easily that identity and inverses are unique. You also have what in Galien is referred to as the Shoesock's formula or Shoesock's lemma, which tells you that AB inverse is B inverse A inverse. And of course, if you just have a binary operation, which is associative, if you're just looking at a non-empty set with that that much of property on the binary operation, then we call it a semi-group. So a group is a semi-group which has identity and inverses. And what are the examples? I mean, you look for one and you'll find one. The number systems that we have, integers, rationals, real numbers, complex numbers, are all infinite abelian groups under addition. The natural numbers is a semi-group under addition, but not a group because there's no identity element. The identity element for these number systems are zero. And then if you look at the non-zero rationals, non-zero reals, non-zero complex numbers, they are again infinite abelian groups under multiplication. And where, as I said, the notation F star denotes F minus zero. So the non-zero numbers. And Z, Q, R, and C are, if you look at them under multiplication, they're semi-groups with identity, but they do not have, but they're not groups. Z star, which is Z minus zero, is again not a group because there are elements in it which do not have inverses. And this is an example that we are going to come back to time and again. If you start out with a non-empty set and you take all the bijective functions on that set, I'm going to use the term Sx to denote it. Sx is called the group of permutations of X or the symmetric group on X. And you can check that it actually does form a group under composition of functions. And here are some interesting results. I've just stated this. I think you should, as part of your review, you should try and prove these things. So if X itself has three or more elements, then Sx is non-abelian. If order of X is n, then we generally take Sx to be group of permutations on the numbers 1, 2, 3 up to n. And we denote it by Sn. And its order is n factorial. And if X has infinitely many elements, then Sx turns out to be an infinite non-abelian group. So, I mean, they may seem as things that you do know, but I would urge you to try to prove these in general. So you don't know what your X is. All you know is that X has three or more elements. So try and prove that you can find two permutations in Essex which do not commute in order to show it is non-abelian. The third part, if you know that X has infinitely many elements, then can you prove that there are infinitely many permutations? Again, that's something that you should think about carefully, and also think about what are the things you're going to assume from set theory in order to be able to do it. And so think about this, and then maybe in, when we have our next lecture tomorrow, maybe some of you can tell me in the last thing, what is it that we assume when X has infinitely many elements to prove that the group of permutations on it will actually turn out to be infinite. Okay. And this, I mean, you're going to both Amit, in fact, right from today, and I certainly in my last lecture, we are both going to be looking at groups of symmetries. So when we looked at X just as a set without knowing what its elements are, without maybe knowing that it is part of some kind of a geometric, that there's some geometry on that set. When we looked at just the set alone and talked about bijective functions, we got a group of permutations. But now we are going to be concerned with the sets X. I mean, I have said here that X is a non-empty subset of R to the power M. So for you, R square is just your plane. R cubed is the space we live in. And of course, you have encountered R to the power N as part of vector spaces, possibly. It's like a coordinate system that you have, where each point is recognized by the M coordinates, M real coordinates that is associated with it. Now, the point is that there is this notion of distance, right? Whether it is on the real line or in the plane or in the space around us. If I take two points, all of you would intuitively understand that, what it means for the distance between those two points. And in fact, in school, you do learn a formula which tells you that if you know the coordinates of these two points, you can actually write down what the distance is between them. But if you studied metric spaces or you're going to study metric spaces, that generalizes this notion of distance. And if you, you can talk about this group of symmetries for any set which has this concept of distance in it. So it needs to be a subset of a metric space. So what we're going to define is that if X is a non-empty subset of R to the power M, if in your mind think M as 2 or 3, that's, and you'll be comfortable. We are looking at all those functions which are bijective on X and also preserve distance. That means if two points were at a certain distance before you applied F on it, then their images would also be at the same distance. And it's a two-way thing because we have a bijective function going. So these, when we talk about symmetries of such an X, we are actually talking about permutations of X which have a further property, namely that they preserve distance. And you'll see this idea coming up again and again in groups, this notion that you get a group when something is preserved. And I think Amit will talk to you a lot more about this in his lecture. But for now, I want to concentrate on the fact that if you take the collection of all symmetries of X, they form a group under composition of functions. And some of the ones that you might already be familiar with are, for an equilateral triangle, for example, if you look at its group of symmetries. Then it turns out that there are three rotations and three reflections. And the group that you get is essentially the same as S3. But if you look at a square, again, it has four, its symmetries consist of four rotations and four reflections. And you can think of these symmetries as doing something to the vertices of your square. And that's how you track them. So in a sense, you can think of them as sitting inside S4. But of course, now you don't get the whole of S4. You have a subgroup of order 8, which is sitting inside S4. I mean, I've jumped the gun because subgroups are going to come later. But anyway, very quickly, if X is a regular n-gon, then symmetries of X consists of n rotations and n reflections. I'm going to use D2n to denote this. In many books, it's written as dn. Maybe you are more used to dn. Anyway, we'll make it very clear to you. I think here it's best if Amit and I stick to the same notation, and we'll figure this out and tell you exactly. But you are probably used to D4 as your group of symmetries of a square. And you can look at it for rectangles. That gives you the Klein's 4 group. And there is, you can also create objects which have only rotations as their symmetries, planar objects, finite planar objects. Okay, and their symmetry group turns out to be cyclic of order n. Matrix groups, again, general linear group, which is the invertible matrices, n cross n matrices, that forms a group. If you look at matrices in general under addition, it forms an infinite abelian group. When you're looking at the general linear groups over a field, and the field is what is called a finite field, then you can actually, it becomes a finite group, and there are interesting things that you can study about its structure. Group addition modulo n, multiplication modulo n, again, these are things you should be very familiar with. The quaternion group, it's given as one of the examples for a group whose every proper subgroup is normal, but the group itself is not abelian. And then you have your subgroups. When is a subset of a group a subgroup? The subgroup tests. So, you know, in Galien, this is called the one-step subgroup test, the two-step subgroup test, and the finite subgroup test. Examples, again, I'm going to go over this very quickly because this is all stuff that you've done. In the general linear group, we studied, looked at special linear groups. And then alternating group is something that's important. The cyclic subgroup is extremely important. Okay, the notion of generators, how many generators will you have? All of these things are stuff that you would have already looked at. Some special subgroups, the centralizer of an element, centralizer of a subgroup, normalizer of a subgroup. Little results about combining subgroups. When is the union a subgroup? When is the product a subgroup? The intersection is always a subgroup. And this formula that you have for finite subgroups, irrespective of whether the product is a subgroup. Subgroup generated by a subset. Again, this is generalizing the notion of a cyclic group. And when you have that G is generated by a subset and that subset is finite, then we say that G is a finitely generated group. Order of element, again, the formula you should know. If A has finite order, then what can you say about A to the power M? And what happens to a cyclic subgroup generated by A? the results related to cyclic subgroups, groups, that is the subgroup of a cyclic group is always cyclic. What kind of generators can you find in an infinite cyclic group, in a finite cyclic group? And the most importantly, in a finite cyclic group, the fact that there's a one-to-one correspondence between the subgroups of a finite cyclic group and the divisors of the order of the group. Then you would have done cosets. From cosets, we come to Lagrange's theorem. It's one of the nicest theorems. It's one of my favorite theorems in group theory. And you really can actually visualize the proof in this case. It basically says that if you have a finite group G, then the order of a subgroup divides the order of the group. And I won't go into it, but I just want to say that there's a class of groups where you want to know whether the converse of Lagrange's theorem is true or not. So they're called CLT groups, you know. And there is actual research that is done in it's sort of in the interface of number theory and group theory, where people are trying to look at, they call numbers CLT numbers if groups of that order automatically have the converse of Lagrange's theorem being true. So it's interesting that very simple ideas that you have learned in your undergraduate course in group theory can lead to research questions being developed around them. So, I mean, A4 is given as the example where converse of Lagrange's theorem is not true, but I would like you all to think about this question that, you know, can the type of number that N is determine that any group of that order will have the converse of Lagrange's theorem holding in it? So think about that question. And consequences of Lagrange's theorem, of course, Fermat's little theorem, Euler's theorem. And you know that one of the most robust encryption systems, the what is called RSA, follows from Euler's theorem. So groups, I mean, not only are they all around us in terms that they measure symmetry for us, or they allow us to talk about symmetry. They're also actually used in many, many things, and we don't realize that how they're getting used, in fact. Often we are so caught up in the abstract group theory part of it, we don't realize the many places in which groups have found their way. And of course, from subgroups, you go to normal subgroups. These are very special subgroups. When you look at the cosets of such a subgroup, they form a group. In a way, I mean, to me, the condition of one of the equivalent definitions of normality is that if you multiply two of its right cosets or two left cosets of a subgroup, if it again turns out to be a left coset, then such a subgroup is normal. That, in a way, is how I would think of normality coming up. Because once you've created cosets, obviously you realize that you could multiply them, and you want to know whether that multiplication forms an operation or not. And once you have, of course, a normal subgroup, then you can create what is called the quotient group. And all the examples of subgroups that you have looked at, you go back and try and see which ones are normal and which are not. And there are some conditions which allow you to state that a subgroup is normal and when it's not. And suppose you have a group different from identity and its only normal subgroups are identity and itself, then we say that such a group is a simple group. Now, simple groups are extremely important because they actually form what are called building blocks for your groups. that maybe that's not something that you may have encountered in the group theory that you've studied, but in a way, you can at a next stage in group theory, that's something that you study. How can you break down your group in such a way that you find what are the building blocks of that group? And those turn out to be simple groups, simple quotients which are associated with that group. And conversely, if you're given these simple groups, how can you, what are the groups that you can reconstruct using them as building blocks? So that's something, and a large part of research in group theory, in fact, in the for a large part of the 20th century, this was the big exercise. Mathematicians from all across the world were involved in this, which was to classify the finite simple groups. So you wanted to have a kind of a library in which you would know what are all the different types of finite simple groups, their properties, what they look like, and so on. And sometime in the 80s, it was declared as completed, and the proofs run to about 30,000 pages. And in fact, Galien has this these very nice poems in the latter chapters, which is not part of your syllabus. Go back and read it. There are simple groups called monster group and baby monster group, and there are poems on. There's a poem on how a lot of these simple groups were discovered, and it's great fun. Anyway, the simple, you've encountered simple groups. Any cyclic group of prime order is simple. And you might have encountered the fact that A5, the alternating group on five letters, is simple. And indeed, AN is simple for N greater than or equal to 5. The smallest, A5 is the smallest non-abelian group. All groups below order 60, if they're non-abelian, they are not simple. Okay, quotient group, again, something that you can construct once you know you have a normal subgroup. The cosets form your group, and you can do various things in them, and it gives you a very good tool for exploring finite groups. Commutator group is again something which we will, remember I talked to you about this property, group theoretic property that Galois used to try and, when he linked solving by radicals, I talked about that property as solvability. So you would have encountered what is called the commutator subgroup or the derived subgroup of a group. And so for the group G, then you have its derived subgroup G dashed, which is the subgroup generated by all its commutators. And the commutator basically measures by how much X and Y do not commute. In the sense that if X and Y do commute, then this commutator will always be identity. Now, once you have the commutator, you have G, then you can look at its commutator subgroup G dashed. G dashed itself is a group, so you can look at its commutator subgroup G double dashed, and so on. If at some point as you keep taking derived subgroup of a derived subgroup and continue with that, if at some point you hit identity, then such a group is called a solvable group. And what you realize in group theory is that, solvability of a group gives you a lot of very, very nice properties that the group will satisfy. And one of the nicest properties is that if the Galois group associated with an equation is solvable, that means if you look at its derived series, it actually ends at identity, then the equation will be solvable by radicals. And you'll see that if this derived subgroup is actually a normal subgroup of G, it's also what is called a characteristic subgroup, which we might come to later. But So if you have a, if G is simple, then the only choice that G dashed has is either to be identity or to be the whole group G. If it's identity, it can be identity if and only if G is abelian. So if you start out with a non-abelian simple group, then you will find that G dash turns out to be just G. And the derived series will just get stuck there. It will never reach identity. So solvability is something which is very interesting. It helps us to understand the structure of the group a lot more. And usually when you're studying groups, you look at cyclic groups. In a way, they seem to be the simplest. Then you look at abelian groups. Then there is something called nilpotent groups that you study, and then solvable groups. So there's a little hierarchy of the conditions that you assume on a group, and then you get more and more structure with the groups that you're looking at. I've given you a little exercise here, which is that for S3, find its derived subgroup. Homomorphisms and isomorphisms, again, there are the three isomorphism theorems, which are very important. You should keep them in mind. And automorphisms, which are isomorphisms from the group to back to itself. One-to-one, onto, and homomorphisms. And there are results related to automorphisms. Maybe you may not have encountered this as yet. So if I'm using it at some point, I will probably explain it a bit more. So I want to stop this. It was supposed to be a quick introduction, but I've probably gone on for quite a while with this. And now I'm going to actually start the group actions part, and for which I'm going to move to my tablet. So I'm going to shut this and I will reshare a screen with all of you. Again, can all of you see the screen that I'm showing now?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
It's visible. Okay, so I've given you a potted history of groups, and I've also reviewed group theory for you. I mean, what you probably have done in an entire semester in about half an hour, 40 minutes. And what I want to do now is to start with the basics of group actions. Okay. And as I mentioned, this is like a full circle that we are coming back to. The origins of groups was as operators. And by the end of the lecture today, we'll see that every abstract group can also be thought of as a group of operators. Okay. And since this is going to be possibly new for you, so please make sure that you understand what I'm saying, because you're going to have a lot of things that both Amit and I are going to talk to you in the next 3 days. And you're also going to have tutorial sessions. So it's going to be very intense. And unless you are following what is happening during the class, during this lecture itself, you might find it difficult. You won't have enough time to digest what is there and to be able to, think about the questions which we have given you in your tutorials. So the point that the term group actions itself should indicate to you that we want our group, the elements of our group, to act on something. In a way, you can literally think of the group as, like a digging crane whose claws are coming down. And you have this set which has these elements, and somehow the group element is, picking elements and changing their positions around in the set. That's you know, the kind of mental picture you can have, but formally, how do we define this? So let G be a group, and let X be a non-empty set. Okay, one of the things I must mention before Amit does his presentation is that he has a fantastically nice handwriting. And so you must forgive me for my scrawl. He claims that his writing is scribbling, but you'll realize when he does his presentation that if you could print handwriting, then it would be like Amit's handwriting. And mine is the opposite of that. Okay, so usually in class, when I'm writing on the board, you know, the size of the lettering that I use suddenly shrinks. And then the students are shouting at me, ma'am, write bigger. So if you find that while I'm writing in this tablet that you're not being able to understand what I've written, please interrupt me and ask me to tell you. So we have G a group and X a non-empty set. And we want G to do something to elements of G to do something to the elements of X. So what is the basic set in which we have to think about our group action? It's nothing but G cross X, right? Because this will have as first coordinate elements from G and as second coordinate elements from X. So an action of G on X is nothing but a function phi from G cross X. So remember here the element is G comma X, right? And you want G, this little g, to do something to X and keep it back in X. So you need your function to go from G cross X to X, and the element G comma X will go to the element which we write as phi of G comma X, and it belongs to the set X. But notationally, this is quite, you know, terrible, as in, you know, I have an ordered pair here, then I have this function which is supposed to, this is supposed to indicate that element of X to which this function takes G comma X. So instead what we do is, once we know, and the function has to satisfy some, phi has to satisfy some properties. I won't say what they are right now. There are two properties that it has to satisfy. Only then will it be called an action of G. But before I tell you what those properties are, I want to have a nicer notation. See, one of the key things when you're doing maths is because the moment you know, you fix your notation and you have some nice way of expressing things, it becomes easier to understand it also. So instead of using this notation, what we are going to do is we are going to think of G comma X to be taken to G dot X, which belongs to X. Okay, so this, instead of using this notation, I'm going to use this notation, and it is understood that there is an invisible function phi, which is taking you from G cross X to X. Okay? So right now, I've not used anything about G being a group. I've only said that, you know, I have these two sets, G and X, have formed G cross X. I have a function which is taking me from G cross X to X as, and I'm denoting it by saying that this little g, when it acts on this little x, takes it to the element g dot x belonging to x. Now, where does the group part come in? It comes in when you want to talk about the properties that phi has to satisfy. So for the action, for group action, you need first this function, which takes you from g cross x to x. Then I'll call that zero. Then the first property that you want is that if you have identity of the group, which I'm denoting by one, and that acts on x, what should actually happen? I mean, see, the point is that the action is somehow allowing me to think of these elements of the group as permuting the elements of capital X. Okay, so I want to think about the elements of my group really as permutations on the elements of X. So you would, you know, if you want things to be nice, then you would expect that the identity element in G should really be acting like the identity permutation. Now, what does the identity permutation do? It's the identity map. It will take every element back to itself. So you want 1 comma x to go to 1 dot x, which you want should be x. So, you know, instead of writing it in this way, basically what we write is that for every g belonging to g and for every x belonging to x, g dot x should belong to capital X. That will be my 0th condition. The first condition that I want is that 1 dot X should be equal to X for all X belonging to X. 1 is identity of G. That's the symbol I'm using. And the second, sometimes I'll use 1, sometimes I'll use E. So if you get confused, just stop me and ask. So this part, I've explained to you where it comes from. We want to think about the identity element of G as the identity permutation when you're looking at the permutations on X. So we would like it to have this property. But there's something else that you can do, right? So suppose I take if I take two elements G and H in my group G, then and X in X, then I can first look at, then I can, you know, in the group form the element GH. That acts on X. Okay. And on the other hand, I could have had H act on X. That gives me an element in capital X, and then G acts on that element. And you want these two things to be same. In a way, what you're saying is that the group operation and the action of the group on X are compatible with each other. And if you look at this a little bit more carefully, in a way, it's telling you that the group elements, when you are thinking of them as permutations, are acting like composition of permutations. So very simple things that you require for a group action. One is we say that the group is acting on the set X, group G. If you have a function from G cross X to X, and this is the way we define the image under that function for the element G comma X. And what do we require? That this g dot x should again come back to x. So the little g takes the little x and moves it to some other element of capital X. One should act, the identity of g actually acts like literally like the identity function on x. And further, the multiplication in your group, so there's an invisible star here, which I'm not writing, should be compatible with the action that you're trying to define. So if you have these three conditions, then we say that the group G acts on the set X. Now, what are examples? Usually, one of the first things that we do is to see, you know, to take care of all the trivial examples. So I'm going to give you some. The first one is what is called trivial action. Okay. So here you can take any group G and any non-empty set X. And the action is that G times X, we define G times X to be X for all G in G and for all X in X. And you can see, I don't have the time that I can actually verify these three conditions for you formally. Okay, so I'm going to write down all these examples, and what I want all of you to do as an exercise, this is along with what you get in the tubes, do the verification that these are actions. But you can see very quickly, basically what you're saying is that each G is also acting like the identity function in a way, right? So this is called the trivial action, where each element of G does nothing to the set, the elements in capital X. It just keeps everything where they are, all right? So for any group G and any non-empty set X, you can look at it this way. The second example that I'm going to give you is, again, something that you are very, very, we've already looked at it as an example. So you have X, which is non-empty. And let's take G, which is SX. You remember this was all a group of permutations on X. So this was the set of all bijective functions on X. And what you do here is that you take a G in G and you take a X in capital X. But this G, remember, is already a permutation on X. So it's a bijective function on X. So you just define G dot X to be G, the function G, where it takes X2. All right. And again, you'll be able to check that this does give you a group action. And so this is one of the most natural actions of this particular group on this particular set. The third, so for example, if I take X to be 1, 2, 3, and S3 as my G, and I take the three cycles I, 1, 2, 3. Then what do I know about xi of 1? Xi of 1 then will be 2. Xi of 2 will be 3. And xi of 3 will be 1. That's what this thing is telling you. Okay. In a way, it's saying that the elements are already permutations on X. So it's just keeping that same thing here. On the other hand, if I take X as a subset of Rm and G as sim X, again here, G dot X, because remember what sim X is here, it is the set of all bijective functions on X, which also preserve distance. So here G dot X will again just be GX. G applied to X. And as an example, suppose I take a square as my X. And I take the vertices, I call them 1, 2, 3, 4. So x is my square, and g is, okay, I'll stick to your notation d4. Okay, rather than d2n, I'm sticking to dn as the notation. Okay, so d4, say let's take rho to be the 90 degree rotation about the center in the anti-clockwise direction. Then what is the action of rho on the element 1? So my set x, even though it's the square, I'm going to think about it basically as 1, 2, 3, 4, just the vertices. The reason being, if I know where these four vertices go, I know where the entire square goes. So it makes sense for me, instead of taking all the points in the square, to instead concentrate only on these four points. So rho dot one, so when you do a 90 degree rotation, what happens? One will come to 2, 2 will go to 3, 3 will go to 4, and 4 will go to 1. So rho dot 1 will be 2, rho dot 2 will be 3, rho dot 3 will be 4, and rho dot 4 will be 1. Okay? So this is how, when you look at the 90 degree rotation, the way it is going to act on these four elements. And like that, you can figure out what happens to the 8 elements that are there in D4. There are 4 rotations. The 0 degree rotation is, of course, the identity of your group. And then you have 90, 180 degree, 270 degree, and you have reflections. Okay, maybe let's look at one reflection, maybe the vertical reflection. Let me call it FV. And I mean, here again, the notation is probably, I think Amit will call this something else. You'll have to bear with us as long as you understand that we are both talking about reflections only. So in the case of FV, you'll find that FV on 1 is 4, FV of 4 is 1, FV of 2 is 3, and FV of 3 is 2. Okay, so that's the kind of thing that you have. Another important example, this comes from vector spaces. So suppose I have a vector space V over a field F, then I want to know, you know, what is my what is my set and what is my group here? Now the group that I'm going to look at is F star. This is the multiplicative group of the field, non-zero elements. Group of F, which is nothing but F minus 0 under the multiplication in the field. And the set X that I'm going to look at is the vector space itself. So remember that the elements of your group are what you call scalars, non-zero scalars. And they are going to, you want them to somehow act on the vectors. And you already know V is a vector space over the field F. So the most obvious way in which you can define the action is that if I take a lambda belonging to G, and I take a V belonging to X, then lambda dot V will be nothing but lambda V, which is the scalar multiplication. And again, you can check that this will give you a group operation. So this was my fourth example. But the most interesting of examples come up when you get the group to act on itself. Okay, so I'm now going to concentrate on some actions in which the set X then itself is a group. And so the first is G acts on itself by left multiplication. Okay. Again, and in the way in which I've written this, you can figure out what your action is. So G is equal to X here, and I basically my G dot X is nothing but GX. This is group operation that we have. All right. We'll come back to this. This is going to be something we'll come back to later. The other thing, again, it's there as part of an exercise in your tutorial sheet. G acts on itself by conjugation. Okay. So again, here G is equal to X, and G dot X is being defined as GX G inverse. Okay, this is the conjugation in G. Right. So the action, how does little g permute X? It conjugates X and takes it to a suitable element in the group. Now, it would be good for you. So check these two things, right, in S3. Of course, no point in checking this in an abelian group, correct? Because in an abelian group, what will happen? This action will become a trivial action, because GX G inverse will then just be X, and all you'll be defining through this is G dot X equals X. So in S3, check out what's happening, you know? So take phi belonging to S3, where phi is the 2 cycle 1, 2, and check what phi of phi dot X is for X belonging to S3 in both cases. And that will give you a hands-on feel for how, say, left multiplication is permuting the elements versus how conjugating by phi is permuting the elements. Okay, so these will give you two kinds of examples that you can. And you can have similar actions, but now not by G acting on itself, but G in conjunction with a subgroup of G. Okay, so the seventh thing that I'm going to look at is G acts on left cosets of a subgroup H by left multiplication. So what is your set X here? X is the set of all left cosets as A varies over G. And so how does a little g act on an AH? It takes it to G, the left coset GAH. Okay. This again is something which has come in your tute group question. There's a tute question coming from this. There's a tute question coming from 6 as well. Okay, 8, conjugation action on the subgroup. So G acts on So how do I want to write this? So on well, you can think of it in the following way. G acts on the set of all subgroups of G by conjugation. So what is X now? X is H subset of G such that H is a subgroup of G. And what is the action of G on a subgroup H? This is nothing but GH, G inverse. And you know that if H is a subgroup, GH, G inverse will also be a subgroup. And you can verify that this indeed gives us a group action. So why do we even go into group actions, right? Now, what you'll see as I develop the theory of group actions is that, first of all, the group acting on a set gives us a very nice way of thinking about the group elements as permutations on the set. So that's one of the first things that we will see. Second is that we'll associate various things with respect to G called orbits and stabilizers. And through that, we will be able to develop the theory of group actions a bit more, and it will give us a plethora of results which have direct relevance to our groups. So this is what is called the permutation representation. Okay, so this is a little theorem that we have here. Let G act on the set X, on the non-empty set X. See, when I say let G act on X, you should automatically assume that the set X is non-empty. I may not say it every single time, but I'm assuming that when G acts on the set X, the X set X is non-empty. Then there exists a homomorphism phi mapping G to SX. Okay, so what this theorem is telling you really is that you can think of elements of G, instead of little g in G, you can think of their counterpart phi G, which belongs to SX, and that phi G is nothing but a bijective function on X. And this is called the permutation representation of G induced by the action of G on X. I suppose I should tell you a little bit about the terminology. When G acts on X, then X is called a G set. Okay. So very quickly, let's look at this proof. I might not do all the details of the proof. Again, I will leave that as an exercise for you. And when you try to write down the details of the proof, you will understand what is going on before. Okay, so what we want to do is we want to be able to associate with each element G in G a permutation in SX. Only then will we actually be able to define this homomorphism phi. So let us define phi mapping G to SX as follows. Just give me a second. Okay, sorry. So let's define phi mapping G to SX as follows. So for every G in G, we define phi of G to be, I'm going to write it as phi subscript G, where, see, so I start with a little g in G, and I want to get a function which is bijective on X. So I've denoted this function as phi G. Now I have to tell you what it does on elements of X, where phi G maps X to X as phi G on a little x should be what? Now the only thing we have with us is that G is acting on this non-empty set X. So the most obvious thing would be, see, and I want a function from X to X. So phi G is going to take the element little x, and the most obvious thing it can take it to is G dot X, right? The element to which X goes to when G, little g, acts on it. So what do you have to show? You have to show phi G is a function. And then you have to show that phi G is injective, phi G is onto. And I'm going to leave this as exercise for you. So you have to use the property of group action. Remember, the group action itself is a function from G cross X to X. So if you utilize the properties of group actions, then automatically you will be able to prove these things. Now, once you prove this, therefore, what we have is for every G belonging to G, phi G belongs to SX. Okay. And you can verify that if G1 and G2 are same in G, then the corresponding images phi G1 will be equal to phi G2 as functions in SX. Okay, therefore, this map, phi mapping G to SX, is a function. Okay, so that's the first thing we wanted, that it, we wanted to show it's a homomorphism. So now we've got that it is definitely a function, and let's check what happens for homomorphism. Homomorphism, basically we have to show that this, as a function, this is compatible with the group operation. So we, to show phi is a homomorphism, we've already shown function. So now we have to show that phi of GH is equal to phi G. And what is the operation in SX? It's composition. Phi G of phi H in SX. Or this is the same as showing that phi GH is the same as phi G of phi H. Yeah, and this is pretty easy to see. Now, for every X in X, what is phi GH on X? By definition, this is GH acting on X. But because we have a group action here, we saw already this is the same as G acting on H acting on X. Okay. But now let's write down what H acting on H is, and what does it mean when G acts on an element of X? That's nothing but the definition that phi G is being applied to the element H dot X. Right? That's just from the definition of phi G. But this again is phi G. And what is there inside our bracket? This is again, what is phi H doing to little x? And what you see clearly, therefore, is that this is nothing but phi G of phi H on the little x. And this is for every single little x in X, that these two functions are behaving identically. Therefore, phi G H is equal to phi G of phi H. Hence, phi mapping G to Sx as phi of G equals phi G, where phi G on an X is G dot X, is a homomorphism. And the moment you have homomorphisms, you have kernels. What is ker phi going to be? Ker phi is going to be the collection of all G in G such that phi G is going to act as identity. So this is the collection of G belonging to G such that phi G on X. So G dot X should be equal to X for all X in capital X. Okay. We say that G acts on X faithfully if ker phi above is trivial. So, and see what happens if ker phi is trivial. If by then, by the first isomorphism theorem, we have that G will be isomorphic to G by ker phi because ker phi is trivial. And this is isomorphic to phi of G, which is sitting inside Sx. Okay, so what you see here is that if G acts on X faithfully, then you can think of G as sitting inside the group of permutations on X. Okay. Now, so every time you have a group acting on a set X, you're going to get that the action gives rise to a homomorphism, which allows you to see G or elements of G as permutations. And then you have this definition that if permutations different from identity, if elements different from identity are giving you permutations which are different from identity, then we say that our action is faithful. And then you can literally think of G as a subgroup of your group of permutation. But you can go the converse way also. So suppose G is a group and X is a non-empty set and phi mapping G to Sx is a homomorphism, then G acts on X using phi. Okay? And what will the action be? We'll define G dot X to be nothing but phi G on X. Okay? Where phi G denotes phi of G. Okay, and you can check that this is a group action. So studying group actions in a way is like studying homomorphisms from G into a permutation group. And now I'm going to come back to group actions and associate with group actions two very interesting sets. One is in X and the other is going to be in G. So let G act on X and let little x belong to capital X. So we're going to define what is called orbit of X. There are different notations, X, orb X. Some use this, some use this. There are all kinds of notation which is used. I will tend to use typically this or this. And now what is this? This is the set of all g dot x's as g varies over g. So why is it called the orbit? So you think of this, there is this little x that you have, and one by one the elements of g are taking it to various other elements in capital X. So it's all those places in capital X that this little x can visit when it is moved around by elements of capital G. So it is what is available as the different spaces to which X can move around in. So it's called orbit of X. And we'll come back, we'll look at some of the examples and see what the orbit of X is under that particular group action. And the other thing that you can talk about again is what is called stabilizer of X. So remember, this is a subset of capital X. This thing is a subset of capital X. You can also talk about what is called the stabilizer of X, which is G subscript X. And this is a subgroup. This turns out to be a subgroup of G. So this is the collection of all those G in G such that G fixes X. So X is fixed. For one particular X, we are looking at the stabilizer. And this is a subset of G. Okay. I'll just prove a couple of results and then we'll look at the examples. One is GX is always a subgroup of G. GX is non-empty as 1 belongs to GX. And second, suppose let G and H belong to GX. Then you know that G times X is X and H times X is X. And by the one-step subgroup test, I want to show that GH inverse belongs to GX, right? So I want to apply GH inverse on little x and show that I again get little x. So the first thing that I do is I work with this. I act both these elements of x by H inverse. Okay, this will imply that H inverse acted on H dot x is the same as H inverse acted on X. And by the group action property, we know that this, or what we have is that H inverse H acting on X is H inverse X dot X. H inverse H is nothing but 1. So we get 1 dot X is H inverse dot X. But this we know is X itself. So H inverse, if H fixes X, then you're basically seeing that H inverse also fixes X. Okay. In a way, we are actually doing two-step subgroup test, but if I now look at GH inverse on X, this is G dot H inverse dot X, and this is going to be G dot X, and which is again just X. Therefore, GH inverse belongs to GX. Hence, by the one-step subgroup test, GX is a subgroup of G. Now, we come to what is called the orbit stabilizer theorem. It says that there is a one-to-one correspondence between the elements of OX and cosets of GX in G. So how do you prove this? I just want a one-to-one correspondence. So I want a bijective function from the orbit to the cosets. So my set A is O of X, and my set B is G is to GX, which is the set collection of all G, GX, as G varies over G. And here the orbit of X we saw is G dot X, as G varies over G. And what is the obvious map? So we define a row going from A to B as row of an element in orbit of X. But an element in orbit of X looks like G dot X. And obviously, which left coset will it go to? It will go to G, G of X. But is this well defined? The reason is that I don't know as of now that the same element in the orbit, X could have reached it via two different elements of G. Right? So let's check. So suppose G dot X is the same as H dot X. Then I should have that G times the left coset of GX with representative G should be the same as the left coset of GX with representative H. So, but if this happens, then by the group action property, therefore, what we will get is H inverse G dot X equals X. So H inverse G belongs to GX. And therefore, you'll get that the left coset GGX is exactly the same as the left coset HGX, or that rho of G dot X is equal to rho of H dot X. And I mean, obviously, this map is taking every element in the orbit to a left coset. So you do get that rho is a function. Therefore, rho is a function. It's clearly onto, and it is injective. You can just reverse this argument, right? You just go in this direction, that will also work. And that is why your rho is bijective. Therefore, rho is a bijective function. But what this means is that, so if we are in a finite situation, this means that the order of the orbit of X is exactly the number of left cosets that you have of GX and G, which is nothing but order G by order GX. Okay, so this is essentially what your orbit stabilizer theorem is telling you. Now, very quickly, let's look at, and one more thing I want to mention here, that these orbits are also equivalence classes. So you can define an equivalence relation on X as follows. For every A and B belonging to X, you can say that A is related to B if there exists a G belonging to G such that G dot A is B. Okay. Verify. So this is, you already have group G acts, is acting on X. Using this action, you can define this relation on X. It turns out to be an equivalence relation. Okay, prove that is an equivalence relation on X. So that means it is reflexive, symmetric, and transitive. Then the equivalence class of X which I'll denote like this, is nothing but orbit of x. Okay, is nothing but, oops, sorry, nothing but O of x. Again, prove this. But once you know that the orbits are equivalence classes, then you have something very interesting, right? You know that if you look at the set X and you have an equivalence relation on it, then it partitions of course, I'm writing a scenario where the picture I'm drawing is where this is only finitely many orbits. But basically, the moment you know that an orbit is nothing but an equivalence class, you know that equivalence classes partition your set. So you have this. So in a finite situation, again, what you have is order of x will turn out to be summation sum I equal to 1 to k order of Oxi, where Ox1 up to Oxk are the distinct orbits. And the orbit stabilizer theorem, particularly now, tells you that this is nothing but order G over order Gxi. Okay, again, this is a very, very useful result to have. Now, very quickly, because I'm actually running out of time, I should have not gone on so much about the history and the review and spent more time on this. I'm sorry for that. But let's very quickly look at some of our examples. So when I have trivial, one more thing and then I will this thing. We say that G acts on X transitively if for every X and Y belonging to X, there exists a G belonging to G such that G can take X to Y. Okay. Now, again, this is an exercise for you to prove that G acts on X transitively if and only if X itself is equal to orbit of X for every X in X. So there's only one single orbit if you have a transitive action. So what typically one should be doing is, so whenever you have a group G acting on set X, you should find Ox, Gx, is the action faithful? Is the action transitive? And what does, so I'll call this as result star, and what does result star give you? What does orbit stabilizer theorem signify? In your particular case, and finally, what does the permutation representation give? Okay, so these are all some of the things that you can ask. Let me take two examples now. F star acting on the vector space V. So if I take the zero vector belonging to V as my X and ask what is the orbit of X. Okay, remember that is going to be the set of all lambda times the zero vector as lambda varies over f star. And you can clearly see that this will have just one element, namely the zero vector. And so what is the corresponding gx? Gx is going to be the whole of f star, right? Because every element, every scalar fixes the zero vector and takes it back to zero. Now, if x is not equal to zero belonging to V, then what is orbit of x? This is going to be the set lambda V as lambda varies over f star. So if you look at what this is just, well, this is right now only a set. And because I'm taking lambda from f star and V is non-zero, I should have called x equals V, which is non-zero. So obviously this is going to be a non-zero vector that you have here, right? But the question is, what is this? So this is like the line through V. So all the scalar multiples of V except the zero. Okay, that's what your orbit is. But what is Gx? Can you guess? Okay, so here you want all the scalars belonging to F star, non-zero scalars, such that lambda V will be V. So I'm going to leave this to you to find G of X. Okay. Let me turn my attention to another of the examples that we did. G acting on itself by conjugation. Okay. Here, what you find is that the orbit of X is going to be the set of all G dot X. G belongs to G, and this is nothing but GX, G inverse, as G varies over G. And this was what was called the conjugacy class of X. And here, what is G of X? This is all those G in G, such that GX, G inverse equals X. And this is nothing but what we used to call the centralizer in G of X. Okay? So the stabilizer is nothing but the centralizer in G of X. The orbit is nothing but this thing. Is the action faithful? What will be the kernel phi of the permutation representation? This turns out to be all those G in G, such that phi G behaves like identity. Okay. Identity of G. Okay, so this is, and what does phi G do? Phi G acts on an element of G by conjugation here. So this is all the G in G, such that you, and it's this IG is basically the identity function of G. So you want GX, G inverse to be identity function on X, which is X, for every X belonging to X, which is nothing but G here. So again, you should recognize this subgroup. This is nothing but the center of G. So you will get that the conjugation action is a faithful action if and only if the center turns out to be trivial. And is it a transitive action? Not necessarily.
Excuse me, ma'am. Can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
Ma'am, can you differentiate between the kernel of phi and the one step in which you have said that this it is equal to centralizer of G? Centralizer of X and G.
Okay, so see, I'll do that. So the action of G acts on G, which I'm taking as X, by conjugation. Right, so that means what? G dot X is defined as Gx, G inverse. Now we said that whenever G acts on X, we have a homomorphism phi from G into Sx given by phi of G equals phi G. And how does phi G act on an X? It is G dot X. Okay, which here it means it is Gx, G inverse. So the kernel of phi, which is how we decided whether the action is fateful or not, is the collection of all G in G such that phi G is identity function on X. So this is the set of all G in G such that phi G on any X behaves like identity function on X, and this must happen for all X belonging to X. So this is the collection of all G in G. What is phi G of X? It's G dot X, which is Gx, G inverse. Gx, G inverse should be equal to X, but this is for, see here you want these two functions to be equal. And two functions are equal if and only if they behave identically on every element of the domain. Maybe the confusion is coming because I'm using the same X, you can use this as Y. So I want GY, G inverse to be equal to Y for every Y belonging to X, which is nothing but G. Now look at this set. This set is a collection of all those elements in capital G which are commuting with each and every Y in G. Right? This thing here is the same as writing GY is YG. Okay? Therefore, curve phi is nothing but ZG, which is the center of G. On the other hand, when I want to calculate, so I'm fixing an X belonging to X and I want the stabilizer of X. This means let's look at all those G in G such that when this little g acts on X, it fixes it. So there's only one element of capital X here, which is X, little x, and it's fixed. So this is the collection of all G in G such that what is the action that we have of little g on X? It's nothing but Gx, G inverse, and I want that to be X. So this is the collection of all those G in G which commute with this specific element X. And so therefore this is nothing but the centralizer in G of X. Okay, is that clear? Whoever asked me this?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Yeah, okay. So one last example and then I'll stop. So let's take G to be S4 and let me take X to be the element 4 belonging to the set 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. And I know that G acts on X. We've seen the action of Sx on X. And I want to calculate what is the orbit of 4. Okay. So this is all those rho dot x as rho varies over S4. Okay, so this is going to be all, look at every single permutation in S4 and look at what it does to x. X is nothing but 4, right? As rho varies over S4. And you'll see pretty much, very quickly you'll see that 4 can actually go to each of the other elements. 4 will always be able to go to 4 through identity. Okay? This is true in any orbit. X will always belong to orbit of X. So orbit of X, and you also know that from your equivalence classes results. So you'll find that this is 1, 2, 3, and 4. What are the examples I can use? Suppose I take rho to be 1, 4, the transposition 1, 4, then I know rho of 4 is 1. If I take rho to be, so let me call this rho 1. If I take rho 2 to be 2, 4, then I know that 4 reaches 2. If I take rho 3 to be the transposition 3, 4, then I see that 4 will also reach 3. So here I have what is called the transitive action. Okay. You'll also be able to check that action is faithful. And what is the stabilizer here? So what is G of this element 4, right? Stabilizer of 4. What you want are all rho in S4 such that rho applied to 4 is just 4. So it's all the permutations on 4 letters which are fixing 4. And you can see what that will be. It will turn out to be something which looks exactly like S3, right? So this will be it. I'm writing equal to, but this is like a copy of S3, which is sitting inside S4. Because what will be the elements that you will get? You will get identity. Then you will get, you know, the transposition 1, 2. You will get 1, 3. You will get 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 3, 2. See, because if the permutation in S4 is fixing 4, then all it has freedom to do is permute the elements of 1, 2, 3 amongst itself. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These 6 elements are what you'll get. And this is isomorphic to S3. This is a subgroup of S4, which is isomorphic to S3. Okay, so I'm going to stop here. And of course, you will have your tutorial session.